All right then, let's see how my last home server video did. Whoa, okay. I guess you guys really liked it then. No, but seriously, the response to that video has been amazing and I cannot thank you all enough for your support. And if I got one thing clear from your reactions, is that a lot of you guys wanted to see a deep dive into my infrastructure as code setup. Because of that, I decided to make a series of videos with a working title IAC Deep Dive, in which we're going to create an infrastructure as code project to set up a home server from scratch. In this video, which is part one, we're going to go through basics of Ansible and write our first little playbook to automate the initial configuration for a Linux machine. This video is geared towards complete beginners, people who don't know anything about Ansible but have some knowledge of Linux, command line, and shell scripting. If you're already familiar with Ansible, feel free to skip this part and make sure to subscribe so you don't miss part two. So, without further ado, let's get started. Ansible is an orchestration and automation tool for Linux, Windows, and BSD-based operating systems. It is primarily used to automate deploying, provisioning, and setting up multiple machines, but we can also use it to automate one home server, since it makes your configuration easily reproducible, idempotent, and resilient. If you want to know more about why Ansible and infrastructure as code are so cool, check out my previous video here, especially the part about IAC. You will pretty much need only one thing for this project, and that is a server that we're going to be configuring. I'll use a virtual machine for that, and you can do the same if you don't have a spare computer. I'm using Fedora Linux as my target OS today instead of Ubuntu, just to show you that Ansible works for pretty much any distro. You should also have access to your server via SSH and have a non-root user set up during the installation with sudo privileges. Ubuntu server enables sudo access for your user by default, and on Fedora server this can be configured during the installation. And that's pretty much it. First things first, we need to install Ansible, and that is pretty simple. I'm on Mac, so I'll use the homebrew package manager and type brew install Ansible. If you're on Linux, you can use your distro's package manager, so for example, on Debian-based distros, it's sudo apt install Ansible. Once that's done, let's create a folder called home server. That is going to be our project folder. Now let's move on to the structure of our project. Ansible has a pretty rigid structure when it comes to projects or playbooks, and some terms like role, inventory, and playbook can definitely be confusing. So let's see what they're all about. First thing we need to do in an Ansible project is tell Ansible what machines we're going to be working on. For that, we need to create a so-called inventory. Let's create a file called hosts and edit it. Here, we need to create a group. I'm going to call it home, and in the group, we're going to create our host. The way a host is declared is basically the name of the host, in my case I'll call it home server, then its IP address or host name, I'm gonna put mine, then the username that Ansible will use to connect to our server, in my case it's not the B, then Ansible connection equals SSH, and finally the private key file. This is going to let us save the effort of manually typing out the SSH password every time we do something with our server. If you don't have an SSH key set up yet, let me show you how to do it. Let's open a terminal window and type ssh-keygen-o-a100-t-ed-255-19. This is the hip new SSH cipher, by the way. And then -f, path to the key, -C, and your email address. Then let's press enter, make the password empty by pressing the enter again. Now you can type ssh-copy-id-i, path to the key, then your username, add, and the address of the server. And that's it. Now let's test the key just to make sure everything works. Good. One more thing that we need to do is create an ansible.cfg file and point it towards our inventory file. Let's create a file, create a group called defaults, and write inventory equals hosts. I'm also going to create a group called SSH connections and write pipelining equals true. This is going to speed up our Ansible commands considerably. Now that we've put our host into the inventory, we need to test the connection so that we know that Ansible is able to communicate with our host. For that, let's go into the directory with our inventory and type this command, ansible all-m ping, and press enter. We want to see success here, and that's exactly what we see. Tasks are the bread and butter of Ansible. They describe what your playbook is actually going to do on your target hosts. Let's create a folder called tasks and create a file in there called essential.yml. Ansible uses a markup language called YAML, which relies heavily on indentation, kind of like Python. Our essential task should basically be able to do the following things. Update all the packages on our target system, install some required software like Vim, Tmux, HTOP, and so on, give our login user passwordless pseudo privileges, and finally harden the SSH configuration and enable public key only authentication. Those are the basics of setting up a fresh server. You'll probably have to do this stuff regardless of what kind of server you're setting up, so I think it's a good first example. Let's get started. So the individual tasks in Ansible have the following format: name, colon, then what the task does. Let's call this one update packages, then the name of the module. Ansible has a module called DNF that we can use for managing and installing packages on Fedora. Then we indent the next line and type name, colon, asterisks, as in all packages. Next, we specify a parameter called state. This is a pretty common one in Ansible, and we want it to be latest, as in update all the packages to the latest state. For apt, the syntax will be a little bit different. You'll have to use upgrade, yes, and update underscore cache, yes. And that's pretty much it. We just wrote our first task. Let's write another one. And for this task, we're gonna use a module called package. We're gonna call this one install essential packages, then write name, and here you can put all of the packages that you want to have in your system. For example, Vim, HDOP, NeoFetch, Tmux, and let's say speedtest-cli. Finally, let's also type state, colon, latest. Now you might have noticed that we have quite a lot of hard-coded values in our code. Username, list of packages to be installed, all of those values are things that we might need later on in the Ansible project in other places. So hard-coding them everywhere is probably not a good idea. Instead, we'll use variables. There are two places in which you can put variables in your Ansible project: group underscore vars and host underscore vars. In group underscore vars, you can store variables that are limited to groups of hosts, which are these things in square brackets that can group multiple hosts. And in host underscore vars, you can store variables for individual hosts. For example, if you use different SSH keys for your host, you can put each of your keys in the host variable file. For now though, we're going to create a folder called group vars. In here, we're going to create another folder called all. In this folder, we're going to create a file called vars.yml. The variables that we're going to store in this file will apply to all hosts and all groups, but we can also override them for individual hosts by putting some different values in the host variable file. Here, we're going to specify our username, minus not the B, and the list of packages that I want to install. I'm going to put that in here as well. In the future, you might need to declare variables that shouldn't be stored in plain text, like passwords, API keys, or access tokens. So we're going to create another variable file that will store encrypted variables. Let's navigate to the all folder that we just created and type ansible-vault create secret.yml. It's going to ask you for a password twice, and then open a file where you can put your secret variables. I'm going to put my super secret password here, and then hit colon X to save the file. Now if we cat the file, you can see that it's just a bunch of gibberish. If you want to actually edit this file later on, you'll have to use the command ansible-vault edit, and enter the password that you specified earlier. And that's it. Now that we have our variables, we need to actually use them in our task file. Let's go back to it and replace all of our hard-coded values with variables. In Ansible, variables have to be surrounded by double curly braces and quotes. Now, as you might remember, we have two more things to do in our target system: harden the SSH configuration and enable passwordless sudo. In order to change the values in the SSH configuration file, we'll use a module called lineInFile. This module replaces the lines and files according to the parameters. Let's type name, disable SSH password auth, lineInFile, colon, dest, slash etc, slash ssh, slash sshd, underscore config. Then we're going to specify our regular expression, password authentication yes, and line, that's what we want to replace it with, password authentication no. Last thing we need to do is restart the SSH daemon, but we only want to restart it if there were actual changes being made to the file. So let's write register, colon, sshd underscore config here at the end. That's going to create a variable called sshd underscore config. Next, we type name, restart sshd on config change, service, name is going to be sshd, state, restarted. And then we also write when, colon, sshd underscore config dot changed. So that is only going to execute this particular command if Ansible made changes to the config file. But before we restart sshd, we also need to enable passwordless sudo for our user. For that, we're going to use lineInFile again, but this time the destination file is slash etc slash sudoers. Next, we also specify state, present, and the regular expression is going to be percent sign wheel. We need to replace it with this long line. Finally, we also need to validate the sudoers file to make sure we didn't mess anything up. The reason why you're supposed to use visudo on Linux instead of editing the file directly is because an error in this file can prevent you from using sudo at all, and that is not good. So let's write validate colon slash usr slash sbin slash visudo dash cf percent sign s. This will validate our sudoers file after the edit has been done and revert the file in case it doesn't pass the check. So now that we've created our task file, we also need to create a playbook. A playbook is basically a list of all the tasks and roles that Ansible needs to execute. For now, we only have one task, obviously, but we will be writing more and more stuff in the next parts of the series, so we definitely need a playbook file. Let's create a file called run.yml in the root of the project. Here we're going to put three dashes to signify the beginning of a YML file, then another dash, hosts, colon all, become, colon yes. Become is basically Ansible for sudo. That means that Ansible will run the tasks below this become thing as a sudo user. Now we write tasks colon indentation dash import underscore tasks colon tasks slash essential dot yml. And that's pretty much it. Now we're ready to execute our playbook. Let's open a terminal window and type Ansible dash playbook run dot yml dash capital K double dash ask dash vault dash pass. Dash capital K will ask us for the sudo password, and double dash ask vault pass will ask us for the vault password. Thankfully, you can avoid entering all of those passwords by enabling passwordless sudo, which we just did, and storing the vault password in your OS keychain. But that's a topic for another video. Let's launch our playbook now and see what happens. As you can see, all the tasks have been executed successfully, and the tasks that actually enacted changes in the system were marked yellow. Let's see what happens if we execute the playbook again. This time around, we can emit dash capital K since we just enabled passwordless sudo, and as you can see, there were no changes made to the system, since there's actually nothing to change anymore. So there you go, guys. In this video, we wrote our first Ansible playbook to automate the initial configuration for your typical Linux machine. In the next part, we're gonna go more in depth, and I'll show you how to do more complex things with roles, use Ansible Galaxy for importing other people's roles, how to store your vault password in your system keychain, and other cool stuff. I hope you liked this video, and if you want to see part 2, make sure to subscribe so you don't miss it. As usual, at the end of my videos, I'd like to thank my patrons, Mitchell Valentino, David Love, Edwin, Morse Networked, Prometheus, Laserbat, Julian, and everyone else who supports this channel. Thank you guys for watching, and I'll see you in the next one. Goodbye.